So good afternoon, students, ladies and gentlemen. On the second half of the second day of the orientation, Asian Law College under the Asian Education Group brings to you from our legal lecture series, LLS, yet another tall personality in conversation. LLS is an initiative of AEG which aims at developing a successful legal career that is built on having the right skills. For this, AEG LLS invites professionals from the upper echelons of the legal arena and requests them to share the experiences which inspire and guide students towards innovative thinking, attention to detail, perseverance, and attributes for becoming effective and skilled legal professionals. Few speakers invited under this program include the late Sri Pranab Mukherjee, ex-president of India, Honorable Justice K.G. Balakrishnan, former Chief Justice of India, Honorable Justice Deepak Mishra, former CJI of India, Sri K.T.S. Tulsi, Senior Advocate, Supreme Judge, Supreme Court of India, Honorable Justice A.K. Sikri, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, Sri Rajiv Mohan, Public Prosecutor in the Nirbhaya case, Sri Mayank Pratap Singh, youngest Judge of India, Dr. Kiran Bedi, ex-IPS officer, General Bikram Singh, the former Chief of the Army Staff, Lakshmi Agarwal, the acid attack survivor, Mr. Shiv Khera, a motivational speaker, Mr. Rene de Soynink, CEO, Oxford Institute of Body Language, United Kingdom. Also, this needs mentioning here, the animal law cell at ALC has been incorporated into the system to sensitize students about the animal rights and animal welfare. Its mission running on the lines that a real inclusive society would be the one that nurtures not only the diversity amongst human beings, but one which concerns itself with the cause of living beings. On behalf of Asian Education Group, I welcome you all to this webinar, The Indian Constitution, Know Your Rights, in conversation with the soft-spoken but audacious, resolute, and courageous Additional Solicitor General of India and a senior advocate of the Supreme Court, Ms. Aishwarya Bhatia. Let me acquaint you with our guest today. Ms. Aishwarya Bhatia was appointed as the Additional Solicitor General of India on the 30th of June, 2020. She was designated as a senior advocate by the Supreme Court of India in March 2019, becoming the first. She has served as the secretary to the Supreme Court Bar Association and was appointed as the Additional Advocate General for Uttar Pradesh in the Supreme Court in 2017. She has been advocate on record of the Supreme Court for 13 years prior to her designation as a senior advocate. She has been the counsel for the High Court of Delhi in Supreme Court and had been a panel lawyer of Supreme Court Legal Services Committee, Supreme Court Middle Income Group, Legal Aid Society, and Amicus Curiae. She has been elected twice as secretary of the prestigious Supreme Court Bar Association, and she participates regularly in television debates and deliberations and national conferences on myriad legal issues of national importance relating to administration of justice and women's rights. She was adjudged the best student advocate of the country in the All India Moot Court competition organized by the Campus Law Center, Delhi University, and also as the best NCC cadet from Rajasthan, having commanded the Rajasthan NCC contingent in the Republic Day camp in 1994. She was selected for the coveted Indo-Canada Youth Exchange Program and represented India for the same in Canada, and has participated in many adventure activities with NCC. She recently represented the armed forces for a petition where the Armed Forces Special Powers Act is in force. She argued that these men are prosecuted for performing the duties and should be guaranteed some extent of immunity from wrongful prosecution. Ms. Aishwarya Bhatia has a total professional standing of 22 years at the bar. Honorable speaker for today, Ms. Aishwarya Bhatia, we welcome you to this platform. The students are waiting to listen to you. I hand over the session to you, Ms. Aishwarya.
Thank you very much, Dr. Supriya. Thank you for those very kind words you took out, sir.
Welcome.
Well, It gives me really immense privilege and honor to be here with young law students. I believe that this is part of the orientation program of young law students who are taking up a profession, taking a dive into the profession. So before I take you on this journey of the Indian Constitution, which I believe is a story that really inspires me a lot. I'm really grateful that the college and Dean Saab chose to give me a topic of my own indulgence, I would say. This is because Indian Constitution, I believe, is something that we all must know, irrespective of whether we want to be lawyers or not. But before I take you on that journey a little, let me tell you, share a little perspective of what I feel, becoming a student of law is when you are taking admission in a law college. What I feel is that you are choosing to become students of law for life. This is not a profession. This is not an education that ends with your college. This is not an education that begins only at the doorstep of your college. Of course, the college plays a very pivotal role in a formal, education. But this is an education that really it is what you grasp, what you absorb, what you observe, and what you feel. It's a lifestyle. It's a way of life. Choosing a profession in law, choosing to have legal education, is like you are enrolling yourself to be a student for life. So welcome to be students of life. And trust me, it's a wonderful journey. Initial years can be a little tough because law is a profession that is heavy on experience. It's not your instant coffee, instant noodle kind of education or profession. Unlike what we as a generation like, this is... what I like to equate with is, you could probably equate it with like a chappan bhog that is prepared for Lord Krishna on very, special occasion. And it takes a long time for that to be ready. So if you're out to make a quick dal chawal, that will also, you'll be able to make it quickly in 5-10 minutes. So be very, very clear. This is not a profession that is a quick fix. This is a profession that is going to take a lot out of you. And the only way to be successful in this profession is to thoroughly enjoy yourself, thoroughly immerse yourself. Just don't try to be a bystander. This is a beautiful stream of law that's flowing. You've chosen to come here. Don't just, dip your fingers or, sit next to it and dip your feet into it. Just dive right into it. That's the only way to do it. And it's a journey in self-discovery too. So you end up discovering who you are. Because lawyers are like social engineers, social doctors, social teachers, if you please, because people don't come to lawyers in happiness. Nobody comes to lawyers when they are happy. People come to lawyers when they are experiencing pain, when they are really hurt, when they are at the lowest ebbs of their life. And if at that time you can help them to get a sense of justice, see, ultimately you may lose your client's case. It's not that you win all your cases, but the client should have a feeling that he has tried his best and he has got a semblance of justice, a try at justice and access to justice. That is the job as a lawyer. If your client believes that, that is a job well done. And if you succeed, if you fail that your client, not fail in the matter, mind you, fail for your client to believe that he hasn't had an equal opportunity at justice, that the price that the nation pays is also a humongous price, because the price is that then people, a common citizen, loses faith in the justice delivery mechanism, they loses faith in the rule of law, and then people are more keen to settle their disputes on the roadsides instead of bringing their disputes in the justice delivery mechanism. So huge stakes, but amazing profession. Now, starting with the topic that is assigned to me, the journey of the Indian Constitution, I'll request Dr. Supriya to please keep a little tab on time. I do get swayed.
Yes, definitely. Not to worry, ma'am.
We are used to, judges being on the other side and constantly, bombarding us with questions or nipping us when we are exceeding our time limits. So if you leave lawyers, without a time limit, they can be quite dangerous. So anyways, let me start with how the Constitution came together. And I always like to tell this like a story, because you have to contextualize it. So you have to go back in time. 70 years hence. So the constitution, the Constituent Assembly was making the constitution, drafting the constitution between the years 1947, when we got our independence, to 26 November 1949, when the Constituent Assembly made it and gave it to the nation. And that day is celebrated as the Constitution Day. Of course, the it was promulgated only on 26 January, which is our Republic Day, which made us a republic. But just imagine now, I'm taking you back in time, 1947 to 1949. This is a time of great upheaval in the modern world that we speak of. This is a time, to just to give you a little context, United Nations last month has celebrated 100 years of its 19th constitutional amendment. And the United States Constitution is not a 100-year-old constitution. It is a constitution which is 250, 300-year-old constitution. They proclaim themselves to be a very mature and highly developed democracy. But it has been less than 100 years that they considered giving, you know, right of vote to women of their country. And that was just the beginning. 100 years back was just the beginning. Women of all colors, women of all genres were given, you know, subsequently. So US, now let me give you a little perspective of Switzerland. In Switzerland, it has taken up till 1971 for women to be able to vote. Now, you know, we may think we are, many of us do not realize the full potential of our franchise. Of course, you're all voters now, adults, so voters, but some of us, you know, don't realize, but not being able to vote. You have a vote and you can't vote for a particular reason. Could be something else, but not being there as an electorate means you are emasculated from the progress of your country. There is a social, economic, cultural emasculation of that entire population who does not have a right of vote. Now, in that perspective, when our constitution starts, I mean, you know, it's loosely also known as a bag of borrowings, but it's actually the amalgamation of the best practices of the world. And we have taken the best practices, like from, for example, from Britain. We have taken the parliament reform of government, rule of law, the legislative process, single citizenship, prerogative writs, which are Article 226 writs, parliamentary privileges, the entire, in fact, the bicameral system is also based on the British system. From Ireland, we have taken part four of our constitution, which is the directive principles of state policy. Now, this is something very, very unique. Because when India was coming together as a new nation, you know, it was itself a miracle that 1/6 of the population of the world, never before, never after, 1/6 of the population of the world comes together to live as a single free democratic country. That itself is a miracle in a sense, and in a sense more so for India, because the kind of pluralism that we have, you know, all religions of the world are here. Different cultures, the way we talk, our, you know, our languages, our foods, our attires, everything is, there's so much of diversity. I think, no, I mean, for sure, no other country, but not even a single continent in the world would have the kind of diversity that India as a country has. So for India to come together as a country, and where were we betting our, putting our bets? Our bets were all on the document that we understand as the grand norm of our country, which is the constitution of our country. And so I'll not tell you what all we have taken from where, but we have taken from Ireland, that was the part four. We have taken from United States of America, the Bill of Rights, the fundamental rights. We have taken from Canada, the centrifugal federalism, which is very different than the US federalism. We have taken the advisory jurisdiction of Supreme Court from Canada. From Australia, we have taken freedom of trade and commerce. There's a whole chapter in the constitution which is about freedom of trade and commerce. From USSR, it was not Russia then, it was USSR. We have taken the whole concept of fundamental duties, which is part 4A of our constitution. From France, we have taken the concept of republic, because many erstwhile colonies of the British, they continue to have queen as their head. So they are not republics. They do. Republic is a country where head of the state is elected. So Australia, Canada, they are not republics. They continue to have the queen as their symbolic heads even today. Of course, they are now contemplating it, but we did it from the day go. And Germany, you know, the fact that fundamental rights can be suspended during emergency was taken from Germany. from South Africa, the whole process of amendment of constitution. Now, our constitution has a very interesting way of amendment. Amendment can actually be done by three mechanisms. One is a simple majority. So there are, you know, things like the name of the states or the borders, etc. So these are things which can be amended by a simple majority. Then there are things which are considered sacrosanct and very important. Those cannot be amended unless there is a two-third majority. And there is a third aspect where issues are so important that there is a harder mechanism prescribed that you need two-thirds of the majority and you need that resolution to be passed in at least one half of the legislative assemblies of each of the states. So that whole mechanism for it to come about. We have even taken from Japan, the whole concept of procedure under law is something that we took from Japan. And then what did we do with our own culture? You have to all go to the library in the parliament. In the parliament of India, there's a beautiful helium gas covered case in which the original constitution is kept. So constitution is not what it looks like in our hands, the blue books or the red books that are there. I will commend to each student of law at whenever you can, of course, I'm not saying now, COVID times does not allow us to go, but whenever you get it, Ms. Sharma, if I can request you to please mute yourself. Thanks. So please go have a look at the Constitution. Hi again. So the original Constitution, which is kept in the helium case, is a beautifully handwritten, calligraphed document, which has been kept in this helium box to keep it preserved. And it has been decorated by Nandalal Bose and his disciples in Shantiniketan. It actually tells the entire historical, cultural heritage journey of India. It has scenes from the Vedic ashram. It has pictures from the Harappan civilization. It has beautiful paintings from the Ramayana, from Mahabharata, Nataraj, from Vikramaditya's court, Nalanda University, the great emperor king, Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, Rani Lakshmibai. The entire history is there and every chapter is decorated with a portion of history. And you will see that this was a very important thing. Whenever you visit Supreme Court, or virtually you could see there is a mother and child sculpture which is kept in the lawns which is very beautifully decorated in the lawns. It's a black color sculpture, mother and child, that's what it's called, in the lawns of Supreme Court. You have to understand, go close to it and understand that the caricature is one of a woman. There's a child sitting in her lap and the child is holding a book. So it symbolizes the child is supposed to be the young Republic of India. The mother is supposed to be Mother India, because we can't leave our thousands of years of culture and heritage. We can't just shun. Why should we? We are so proud to have that heritage and culture. So the Mother India, in her lap is the Republic, young Republic of India, and the book that he's holding is the Constitution. So that really shows the strength of what our system is. And, you will read Constitution. I didn't want to take you through the provisions of the Constitution and telling you what your rights are, of course. But there are some things that I definitely want to tell you. Some of the things which are so, so important and significant in our constitution, those are some of the significant things are the whole system of checks and balances. Our system has a system, our constitution prescribes a system of independence of judiciary. There is a division of powers between the three arms of the state, which is the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. And it is kept in such a manner. Now, let me give you a working example of it. Every day we see that when executive fails or legislature fails, we go to the courts of law. That is the job that is prescribed to the courts of law. And the courts stand up to essentially the constitutional courts stand up and they nudge wherever it is required. They issue mandamus wherever it is required, and whatever is unconstitutional is held to be unconstitutional. And every day that is the mechanism that goes on in our courts. So now what happens if the Supreme Court fails? That is also something that you must know, because Shahbano's judgment, there are our whole system is replete with all the examples where the executive or the legislature failed and the courts corrected. But let me tell you an inverse example. That inverse example happened during the times of emergency. Now, emergency was this dark period when all of our fundamental rights were completely suspended, including the right to life. And anybody could be picked up from anywhere. People were picked up from their homes, from their offices, from their colleges, from the roadside, from restaurants. And there was no remedy that was available to them to have recourse to the court of law. And the executive was not even answerable. Now, this came to be challenged in the court of law. Sorry. Nine high courts in one voice said that the right to life cannot be suspended during emergency. But in the celebrated judgment or the dark letter day of Supreme Court in ADM Jabalpur's case, the Supreme Court and Constitution bench, and consisting of some very respected judges, disagreed with those nine high court benches and said, no, right to life also can be suspended, and it has been suspended, and the courts can do nothing about it. Now, what happens? We don't have a Privy Council. After we have our constitution, the Supreme Court is the final court. So what happens when Supreme Court errs? Interestingly, our system has that system of check and balance that when Supreme Court also failed, then the 42nd Constitution Amendment Act was brought in, and soon after the emergency, and it was provided that while other fundamental rights could be suspended during emergency, right to life could never be taken away, never could be suspended, or you know, even be kept in a suspended animation state for any period during any of the emergency provisions. So that is to give you an example of how the system of check and balances. Now, you know, sometimes we have to see how it works for other constitutions. So China also has a balance of powers. We all know, I mean, whatever little comes out in the media from the Chinese reports, we all know how China operates as a country, but their system of separation of powers, independence of executive, legislature, and judiciary is understood as one mother and three children. So while these three children are executive, legislature, and judiciary, the mother is supposed to be the Communist Party of China. So that is the concept of independence, separation of powers, and independence that is understood there. Now, let's look at another country that gained independence at the same time, actually a day earlier. They celebrate their Independence Day one day earlier than ours. So similar cultural background, similar heritage, same colonizer, independence, same time. Look at what that country has done. In the last 73 years of its existence as a country, as an independent country. Now, please pay attention. The statement that I'm making is very profound. Not even a single head of the state of that country who was elected into the office has been removed by election. Not even a single head of the state elected to office has been removed by election. So what happened to them? Either murdered, removed by coup, thrown away by the SITs made by the army. That is constitution in function. That has what has defined our journey as a country. And there's one more aspect that I really want to highlight. You know, public interest litigation is something so common in our system that we understand it very, very well. Public interest litigation is something that is an exception in the settled principles of law. Otherwise, the norm is locus standi, and it is not just the Indian system. That is how the modern legal system operates, that you know, you can't go to court and say that so-and-so has a problem. So-and-so, whoever has the problem has to come, unless you fall in those exceptions which are provided in the law, that a person is unsound mind, person may be minor or not capable of pursuing a case on their own or fighting a case. Only those exceptions. Otherwise, the principle of locus standi is not a negotiable principle. Now, what do you do in the 1970s when legal aid is also not there. I was looking at, I think you have lectures on, and I think a very robust mechanism of legal aid society also present in your college, which is now a very welcome feature. I realize in most colleges, I have seen law colleges, and your legal aid clinics are doing a phenomenal job. And trust me, this job is required. There are still large masses of people who need this access to justice. I have, you know, throughout my 22 years of my professional standing, I have been a volunteer legal aid counsel throughout in my court, because it gives you a different kind of satisfaction. Profession is not about how much money we can make in the profession. This profession is about how much difference we can make in people's life. And that really defines what your journey becomes. And, you know, this legal aid, now this is also prevalent and also common. This is now brought into, this was brought into a statutory framework in 1987 by the Legal Services Authorities Act. After that, you know, the whole mechanism, and now there are legal aid clinics and committees in every district court in the entire length and breadth of the country. So now that mechanism is dynamic, robust, and law colleges like yourselves are doing a great job with it. But I'm talking about the decades of 60s and 70s. We gained independence, but how do the masses have access to justice? How do these small children who are employed in the toxic factories dealing with barood and explosives in Shivkashi? Diwali is coming. We all like to, you know, light up a little crackers, though we should really be very careful and cautious about it. The air pollution is really taking us nowhere. But those Shivkashi factories were employing small hands, 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, because their hands are small and nimble, but those explosives were getting absorbed. Who could have thought that they had any access to courts? They can't have access to courts. If they had access to courts, they would not be working in those factories in the first place. Public interest litigations allowed those kind of causes to come up before court. Or in the Hussainara Khatun's judgment, in Bihar, there were thousands and thousands of these under trial prisoners who, as under trials, had not been bailed out just because they did not have the bail money, because they were just forgotten. And as under trials, they had remained in custody for longer periods than they would have remained if they would have been convicted of that offense. So, for example, if somebody was charged with robbery, he had, as an under trial, without the trial happening, he had stayed inside the jail for periods longer than his conviction under robbery would have allowed him to, or theft would have allowed him to. So that these kind of cases. So then in 1970s, the public interest litigation was coined. It's not there in the Constitution. It is a departure from the laws as they are understood across the world. But in Indian context, it was necessary. It was brought in, and it has firmly stayed so. Because the kind of public interest litigations that we see today have essentially and increasingly become a lot of publicity interest litigations, but a lot of public interest litigations are still for environmental causes, etc. They still remain and have been doing a yeoman's job. One more interesting example I want to give you of how the Constitution has been transformative. It's a very dynamic document, despite being the longest written constitution in the world. Briefly, Yugoslavia had when it was a combined country, then Yugoslavia had a constitution that was briefly longer than India, but India otherwise continues to have that distinction of having the longest written constitution in the world. But despite that, our constitution has remained a dynamic document. It is not a document which is, it moves with life. And for that, the very apt example that I can think of is the challenge to the provision of adultery. Now, you all would have read 3 years back the Constitution bench of the Supreme Court. I think Joseph Shine's case, they held adultery to be unconstitutional in the IPC. Now, adultery in the IPC was defined in a very colonial era of 18th century, where it said that if a woman had sexual relations with a man outside of her marriage without the consent or connivance of her husband, then it was adultery. Adultery was not how adultery is otherwise understood. So if the woman had those physical relationship with the consent and connivance of the husband, it was okay, and it was considered as an offense against the husband. And it was not just 3 years back, this specific provision came to be challenged on four earlier occasions in the decade of 1950s, in the decade of 1960, 1970, first to start with by the Bombay High Court, then the Supreme Court on three occasions. And at every time, Supreme Court considered the constitutional validity of adultery and said, well, there's nothing wrong with it. It continues in the statute book. And finally, 3 years back, the Constitution bench said, this is an affront to women's rights. And it cannot stay on the in the IPC. It is unconstitutional. It is arbitrary. It is illegal. It is an affront to the dignity of women when you're treating them as chattel. Or what you saw with happened with the Section 377, which criminalized sexual relationship between two adults. That also saw a somersault happening in courts. So this shows that despite there being no, and you know, there's an interesting line that the Supreme Court has said in many of its judgments that fundamental rights are like empty vessels. Every generation has to fill those empty vessels with the wisdom of its own times. So that has been the motto of interpretation and how, you know, in the working of the Constitution, the interpretation has been taken and done in such a manner that it has added relevance to the times that we live in. So those I felt are some of the interesting things about the Constitution, which I have noticed as a student of law in the working of the Constitution. Of course, expansion to right to life, Article 21, single line article. It started with just, you know, that your life and liberty cannot be taken away without procedure established under law. And to start with, the interpretation given to it was very narrow. But then the Supreme Court went on to say that, you know, it is not just animal existence. It is life with all its dignity. And Article 21 has become that be all and end all article of Part 3 of the Constitution, which has encompassed from everything, right to education, right to food, right to health, pollution-free water, air, etc. It has been incredible. The journey of Article 21 itself has been an incredible journey. And we have seen on gender justice also, that is, of course, a topic that is very dear to my heart. I've seen how it works from the latest judgment that we that Dr. Supriya also spoke about of women officers of the Indian Army. It was actually all the three services, Indian Army, Indian Air Force, and Indian Navy. So we've got two judgments of the Army. That was the first one. We've got a judgment in the naval matter also. And the Air Force case is still pending. It got stuck because of the pandemic, but it got stuck on a very interesting point. Now the Army and Navy judgments were already out. Court had said that nothing doing, you cannot discriminate against women, not in this time and not when women had, you know, shown the kind of valor and candor that they had shown. It would be an affront again to their dignity if you denied them equal rights, and an affront to the their male counterparts with whom they had worked shoulder to shoulder. And in the Air Force case, when it came up, the court very interestingly just asked the Air Force counsel and said, you want one more judgment from us or are you going to give this yourself? So it got stuck on that point and they were to come back. So the, those are some of my thoughts. It is, it's of course a great privilege and I look forward to now some interaction from students. If you have any questions, please.
Ma'am, that was so informative and so invigorating and so much energy after spending half a day in court. I think that's amazing. So we have a bevy of questions with us and a couple of students too who would be talking to you. So let's begin with the first one, ma'am, that says, one, through practicing in courts, and second, through competitive examination after completion of the law degree. Which one do you feel is more suitable and why?
The reason why we have so many options is because we are so many individuals. I don't think I can answer this question for anybody else. All that I want to tell you is that I read somewhere that we all must endeavor to become best versions of ourselves. Of course, we do have role models along the way. When I joined the profession, Mr. Jaitley, Mr. Salve, they have been some people who have inspired me thoroughly. And, you know, they're at one point in time, I used to think they are the gods in the profession. And one does try to do things to emulate them. But then it is what gets your goat. It is what excites you. It is what really enthralls you. You know, I know law as a profession. That's the only thing I've ever done in, you know, most of my adult life, a majority of my adult life. But for law, I can tell you, this is not a profession that you can do just with your brain and your eyes and your hands. This is a profession that you need to throw yourself in completely. You have to throw your arms, your legs, your stomach, your heart, your conscience, your, you know, your hair, your nails. You have to dig, you know, and go completely whole hog. And I would understand that most professions work that way. If you really want to, you know, excel in a profession, not in a manner that you rise high, but excel in a manner that people remember you fondly, that you are able to make difference in people's life as much as you can. That, I think, is the real treasure and the real learning. And that can only happen if you truly love. So I will go with the Steve Jobs answer. If you don't love what you do, keep moving till you find something you love.
Okay. So the impasse which arises between the judiciary and legislature is time and again in debate that judiciary is more powerful or is the legislature more powerful? What is your opinion on this?
You know, I gave that example of the balance, the judicial, the institutional balance that is prescribed in our constitution. Actually, it is meant to be like that. The judiciary and the executive and the legislature, judiciary on one side and executive and legislature on the other side, the relationship is meant to be one of uneasy calm. It is meant to be one of without bonhomie. Because by the very nature of a judicial office, the judiciary is required to look at the correctness of the executive orders, to look at the correctness of the legislation that is passed, whether it passes the muster of the constitution. That is the prime and the only role that is prescribed to the judiciary. Judiciary cannot do things. They're not an executive. They don't make laws. Vishakha guidelines was one example which was more of an aberration than a normal course. And there also in Vishakha guidelines also, which was for sexual harassment for women at workplace, those guidelines were framed to say that these guidelines will have the force of law till law is framed by the legislature, because it's not the job of the courts. So we have to understand that we don't want the judiciary to have a bonhomie with them. They have to have this relationship of uneasy calm for all of them to be able to do their job. See, administratively, there's a lot of, they're supposed to be in sync also. But for judicial functions, it is extremely important and pertinent. That is why you see, I mean, judges have so much of independence, their work conditions, their salaries, everything. Constitutional court judges, they can only be removed by a very, very difficult procedure of impeachment. The whole mechanism has been made to ensure that judges have as much independence as they can from the executive and the legislature so that they can do their jobs properly. So I don't think we need to worry about that. That is exactly how the constitution envisages them to be. And I wouldn't go into the, who's more powerful question, because everyone has their jobs cut out within their own spheres. They are sovereign. These are three limbs of the state that we are talking about. All three of them are creatures of the constitution. But in functioning, it appears that the Supreme Court is more powerful because the Supreme Court has the role of being the interpreter of constitution. And that power actually comes from the constitution. So the Supreme Court, that's not Supreme Court's own power. Supreme Court, whenever it's interpreting the constitution, they say that the legislature cannot do this because the constitution says so. So that is the whole working and the mechanism of it. And trust me, no need to worry or feel alarmed by it. Please compare different democracies, different nations, different Supreme Courts. Then you will realize what a robust and dynamic system we have. Our only problem, if I could, you know, biggest problem and the only serious problem that we have is one of delays. And that is a huge problem. I mean, there are too many moving parts in that problem, that our population, our judge to population ratio, resources, judicial resources, huge problems. I hope we can, and we've been having this problem for the last 50 years, but I hope for the sake of a more robust democracy, we can sort that out. But otherwise, there is no tussle going on between the three of them.
So the next question says, the practice of engaging senior counsel with the intention of getting the desired relief from the bench is common in courts. What is your opinion on this?
So I got designated as a senior advocate last year, and this is a huge designation that is given. I got designated by the Supreme Court. So the full bench of the Supreme Court takes a call. They decide whether you're fit enough by your proficiency in law, your special knowledge in law, your presentation, etc., to be given this. So there's no there's nothing that it's not a salary bearing or a emolument bearing designation. It's a recognition of the highest order that you can get as a lawyer. It's a very, very coveted, if I can say, the silk gown is a very coveted gown. And you are right that, especially in the constitutional courts, the tendency of clients be engaging senior counsels is very high. I think primarily, in my experience, I feel there are two reasons for it. And the first reason is that in India, we don't have luxury litigation. In law of torts, you will read that the neighbor's branch came in your house and you did the case, or the neighbor's water came in the house and the case was made. That doesn't happen in India. In India, people come to courts only as a last resort. Now, when they're coming to court as a last resort, that litigation is very important for them. Otherwise, they would not be here in the court of law. Now, if it is very important for them to be here, they would like to do the best that they could, because it is the last resort for them. And that is primarily for the same reason why young lawyers are also not successful, because people don't trust young lawyers. Law is a profession which matures with experience. And let me tell you, it's not just in India. World over, senior counsels, and the senior counsels are not somebody that, you don't pass an exam and become that. That is a designation that is given only by the constitutional courts, either the Supreme Court or the high courts of the state. So once a person has been designated, the belief is that that person has a better standing, he will be able to have better experience of law, and he will be able to deliver in a better manner. So those beliefs can be misplaced, but then aberrations happen everywhere. It's those beliefs that get the clients to engage senior counsels when it is on constitutional courts more so, and the highest courts, so they don't want to take a chance. But trust me, it's not a speed breaker for others. That makes the profession of law difficult for the for younger lawyers. But just keep at it. Perseverance pays off. Nobody's born in the profession with a silk gown. You have to earn it.
Yes, definitely a very exacting profession, from what you're saying. Ma'am, we have Sanskriti waiting in the wings to put her question across to you. Sanskriti?
Good afternoon, ma'am. My question to you is, ma'am, as you are engaged at a very reputed government position as a lawyer, I would like to know the difference which you have experienced as a private practitioner and when you are in the role of a government counsel.
So, Sanskriti, you are right. The position that I am currently holding, Additional Solicitor General of India, is a very important position of a law officer for the country. I am indeed really privileged and honored to be in this position. So essentially what happens is then you are representing the Union of India in the litigations, and the difference in experience is that you feel a lot more responsibility. You are not just representing your client, because the Union of India, as a Union of India counsel, you have to take a fair stand. It is expected from you. It is and rightly so. that you will take a fair stand, and whatever, there's a very interesting letter that somebody sent me when I got appointed as ASG. And that letter was a letter that Mr. Palkhiwala had written to Soli Sorabji when he became the Attorney General. And that letter complimented Mr. Sorabji on saying that the job of a law officer is to ensure that the citizen gets justice in court. Because when citizen wins, when the citizen gets justice, that is what the state wants. So it may appear that it is state versus citizens, but then there are cases that you have to, you know, fairly assess and understand that, you know, why sometimes cases are just out of, bureaucratic hustle and bustle, they are brought in the court, and you as a law officer are required to, supposed to, expected to take a call and fairly assist the court. Even, of course, even as when you're appearing for a private client, then also you are expected to be an officer of the court first before representing your client. But it is easier, it's easier done than said when you're representing your private clients, because your private clients are not engaging you to go out there and, you know, say things which are contrary to their. But as a law officer, as a law officer, if you feel that, you know, the case deserves to be decided in this particular manner, then you say that, and your voice is respected. And otherwise also the responsibility you feel is much higher.
I hope, Sanskriti, you've got your answer to that. All right, ma'am, the next question coming to you. Do you feel that participation in moot court and trial advocacy competitions at the college level while pursuing a law degree helps a law graduate in the actual courtroom practice when they start their career in litigation?
Immensely, I would say. Immensely, because Abraham Lincoln once said that if you give me 5 hours to cut a tree, I would spend the first 4 hours sharpening my axe. So the moot court gives you an opportunity to sharpen your skills, to practice your skills, to understand how you are doing, to understand what are your drawbacks, your pitfalls, how you are faring, how other students are, because it's essentially a mock court. It's not a real court, but they try to make it as closer to it can be. And I have, though in my time, mooting was not really part of the curriculum that it is there now. But I found opportunities and participated in moot court, and I really enjoyed them thoroughly. And it was very, very interesting and exciting skills that I learned at the moot court competitions, not just myself, but by observing, watching. And those were not times that, you know, the courtroom internships that you all have access to and visibility to. We did not have those opportunities in our time. So anything, but anything is wonderful to learn that. And I think as a student of law, what helps the most is if you pretend that everybody in this world is sent to teach you something. And trust me, it's not just people who are higher up than you in the pecking order from whom you can learn. Everybody in the society has something to teach. Not just persons. You have plenty to learn from animals, plenty to learn from nature, the equilibrium that nature has. Just be like a sponge. If you behave and believe yourself to be a student, then you will have teachers in every shape and form. And you can hone your skills anywhere. And if you don't have opportunity at moot courts, catch a friend, catch a sibling, let them hear you out, and you in return hear them out. If you can't get them, get that also, please put a very nice big mirror in your room and speak to the mirror. It really helps, I feel so.
That's so beautifully put across, really beautifully. So the next question says, kindly name a particular provision which you feel is best in the Indian Constitution and has enabled you to deliver justice to people at large.
So I'm going to steal the answer that Dr. B.R. Ambedkar gave when he was asked this question at the end of when the Constituent Assembly finished drafting the Constitution. So he was the president of the drafting committee. The Constituent Assembly had smaller committees, and he was the head of the drafting committee. And when the drafting committee handed over the constitution, mind you, longest written constitution, I mean, about 400 articles, more than 400, if you see the A's and B's that are there, 22 parts, then 12 schedules, humongous. And if you ask somebody who has been the chief architect of that constitution, which is your favorite, it's like asking a mother with 12 children, which is your favorite child? I think it's a very difficult answer, but Dr. Ambedkar said, he also started like that I can't put one as a favorite, but if there is one article which I put at a higher pedestal, that would be Article 32. And the reason is that Article 32 is that provision of Part 3, which allows the recourse to go directly to a constitutional court, Supreme Court, or in 226 to High Court, if there is a violation or even a apprehension of violation of fundamental rights. And, you know, that remedy is so important. And to put that, to make Article 32 itself as a fundamental right, that itself cannot be taken away, is a very important remedy, because otherwise, just to give you from a, you know, a common parlance comparison, suppose somebody was to give you the best of the, if you are Apple products fans, then the newest iPad, the newest iPhone, box of the best chocolates you like, you know, or whatever else your heart desires and fantasizes about, you're given a hoard of wonderful things. But the moment you touch them, you are reprimanded. You can't touch any of them. You can't use any of them. Without Article 32, Part 3 of the Constitution would have been meaningless. It would have not, it would have been diluted. It would have been circumscribed. It would not have had the vigor that it has, because for a violation or an apprehension of violation, you can go straight to the highest constitutional court of the country. And that, I think, is, I would also, you know, believe that to be the most important provision.
Isha Chaudhary, are you there? Yes, Isha, put your question, please.
Good afternoon, ma'am. I'm really being honored to be here in front of you and asking the question. Okay, ma'am, so the question is, as we all know, the recent inhuman Hathras incident case, ma'am, has moved the conscience of entire humanity. Despite of being having provisions in the constitution of women's safety and our state being a welfare state, we are yet to realize that the society which will respect women and give them their due recognitions. So what steps would you suggest, ma'am, in this regard that would help the society to achieve this?
Well, Isha, I must tell you, I wouldn't actually dwell upon this case, because for the reason that I am representing the state of UP before the Allahabad High Court in this matter. And since the matter is sub judice, it is my professional ethics bar me from speaking about this case. But I will, let me answer you in a generic sense, because women's safety is an important aspect of our everyday lives. It is an aspect that we deal with not just professionally, but we all deal with it in our personal spheres also as women. And we have seen how things are. You know, it's extremely difficult for us to understand and accept the fact that despite, you know, women today having broken all male bastions. Today, women are practically in every sphere and every space that men, that was, you know, henceforth known as a male bastion. Despite that, women are still fighting and struggling to fight the basic, you know, the basic struggles of existence and survival, whether it is safety in the public spaces, safety in the four walls of the homes and places that you trust, your workplaces. You know, maximum number of sexual offenses and sexual assaults, 50%, not maximum, but 50, over 50% happen by people who are in a position of trust and, you know, authority with women. So that really reflects really sadly on how the society and how we as people treat 50% of the asset of our nation. It's not like women are liabilities. We've all seen nations are ultimately an amalgamation of families. Family is the primary unit of a nation, of a society. In our families, if we did not have women who were capable of or who were allowed to contribute in whatever manner that they could best do, it's not like every woman wants to be an army officer, but then every man also does not want to be an army officer. Whatever is her capacity, whatever is her aptitude, her inkling, she should be able to contribute. And we have seen that where families where daughters are not given freedoms, those families do not progress and prosper like other families where daughters are given the freedom, progress and prosper. But, you know, we've seen a huge amendment in laws. We saw after the Nirbhaya amendment, the IPC was amended, and very important and significant amendments made. You know, the definition of rape expanded to include any kind of indignity or affront to a woman, to include in the rape, and including offenses which were otherwise considered as innocuous offenses: eve teasing, stalking, voyeurism, acid throwing. These were all included after the Nirbhaya amendments. So a lot of change has happened. But this is the problem really is on multiple sides, from the justice delivery mechanism, starting from the law enforcement. The police as a first point of contact for a crime does not have the sensitivity to deal with the offenses against women still. And also we as families, real enduring change will happen when we as families understand how we are bringing up our sons and our daughters, because these crimes are not committed by people who are coming out of the society. These are crimes which are committed by people from the society. So why we have to have as a society zero tolerance to offenses against women, because we can't allow one half of the population not being able to give its full potential to the nation building.
That's very true. Ma'am, the next question to you is, nowadays, the majority of youth are attracted towards the corporate sector due to the lucrative package which is offered from the beginning of their career when compared with litigation as a career. What is your suggestion on how to make a wise choice?
I think I already covered that in the beginning when I said it's ultimately up to each one of us. What really excites us? What would we really like to see us doing for the rest of our lives? A livelihood or a profession is not just a means of earning money. We have to understand that a livelihood is something that becomes a part of your identity. It becomes who you are. And if you like what you're getting at, if you like what you're becoming or who you are known as, then please, by all means, there's nobody can judge another person on the basis of what they have chosen. But like my mother used to always say, that even if you want to sell golgappas, be the best damn golgappa guy in the town. Don't be the second best. Then whatever you have chosen to be, give in all of yourself and try to excel in whatever field you have been. I am a litigation person. So if you ask me what works for me, I would say litigation is the best thing. There is really no comparison, because I feel that corporate work, a desk job, is essentially paralegal work. The real litigation, the real law in action, is only in litigation. But then choose your choose whatever works for you.
So what has been the role of your law teachers and classroom education in your journey, which is dotted with commendable achievements?
I didn't come from a family of lawyers. My elder brother was the first lawyer in the family. Of course, he has been my role model. He was the one responsible for me to become a. I otherwise wanted to be in the Air Force. As a solo glider pilot, I saw myself flying planes, but I failed a pilot aptitude test. And then my brother told me, why don't you try law? This is a very interesting field. Though my father was in the Air Force, he was in the Judge Advocate General branch. So I had a little idea about interact, but it was essentially court martial, so not like the legal area. But so my professors, law professors were the first ones who, you know, gave us this insight into how exciting law could be. And I'll tell you, it's not all professors of law who leave an impact, you know, on your personality, but there are some amazing professors that I have had, starting from class one, the first class of Hindu law that the dean of my faculty used to take, that class, he was just so amazing. He used to take his subject in such a manner with so much of you know, storytelling, so much of passion. He used to bring it alive. That really excites you. So if you are taught law in the right manner, with the taking it as a life science. Law is essentially a life science. It's a journey of life that we are dealing with. If you were doing a criminal case, you have to be a half doctor to understand what is the kind of injury, whether that wound is lacerated, whether it is an incised wound, which portion of the organ of the body it is, what is the opinion of the doctor, or a ballistic expert. Then you have to understand what is the kind of weapons that are used, what is the explosives used, this gun will create what kind of an impact, will that impact, you know, have multiple wounds, or will it have a single entry and exit wound. It's incredible how you have to get into the complete grain of a case, and the manner in which you are taught how to deal with legal issues or legal problems in your college really has a lasting impact on how you deal with problems, legal issues, when they come to you subsequently. So get inspired. There's so much to be inspired by.
Yes. Pooja, are you there?
Yes, ma'am.
You're waiting for your question? Yes. Please put your question.
Good afternoon, ma'am. Ma'am, as we know, majorly, DPSP is not enforceable, and they are there to serve as a model for government while making policies for welfare of people. But majorly, the provision of DPSP remains still ignored, as they are not justifiable. So ultimately, they are losing the purpose and aim for which the lawmaker, for which they were framed by the constitution. So what is your opinion for the same, ma'am?
Actually, Pooja, if I was to take you through part four of the constitution, which is the directive principles of state policy, if you see one by one, you will see and appreciate that a majority of them have been included in statutory laws. You know, it's interesting to see, initially when we started our journey as a young nation, we did not have enough resources or the wherewithal to have them in a statutory framework. So they were put in as a guidance for future. But to give you some examples, equal justice, free legal aid. Equal justice, free legal aid is now statutorily provided by that 1987 law act of the legal services, the Legal Aid Committee Act. And that 1987 act prescribes free legal aid to women, to prisoners, to children, to disabled persons, to various groups of people. It is already available. There is a provision for equal wages. Now, equal wages is an act which has been already prescribed. So several maternity relief, several of these have been made into statutory laws, and they have been, you know, promotion of cooperative societies. It's very, very interesting. Village panchayats. We saw the constitution amendments taking place for village panchayats to happen. Education has now gone to the fundamental right, Article 21A. This is one right that has traveled from part four to part three of the constitution. But many of these, I think, if the work has really not happened at one place, creches, it prescribes for maternity relief and, early childhood care, education to children, etc. So these, meals being provided to children in primary schools, creches being made mandatory in any workplace which employs more than 50 people, etc. There are enough and more laws that have happened. The only article which has remained elusive and which is very significant to my mind is Article 44 of the Constitution, which required the state to have a uniform civil code. And that, of course, somehow has become a highly political issue every now and then. But this has become a tool for oppression of women at the hands of the religious brokers. That is what it has become. In the name of religion, there's too much of politicizing that is happening. Otherwise, we actually have all uniform civil laws. It is only the matrimony and succession that is not uniform. Otherwise, all other laws, all other relationships that we have with our employer, employee, with our teachers, with our students, you know, who work for us, how we make our house, how we pay taxes, how we make a house, everything is governed by gender neutral, religion neutral laws. But marriage and divorce and succession, these are the only three places. Why? To continue to use this as a tool for oppression of women. And it is so abhorrent that, you know, when women walk into my office for matrimonial consultation, I have to ask them, what is your personal law? Under which law did you get married? Did you get married under the Hindu law, the Muslim law, the Special Marriage Act? It is really, really, it's horrible that India as a country has not been able to achieve that. But otherwise, we have done well.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah, we could go on listening to you, ma'am, the entire day. But just for the paucity of time, we're coming to the last question now, ma'am. This says that in the wake of COVID-19, we are witnessing technological transgression in the legal field to a great extent. Do you feel the adaptation of the technology in day-to-day functioning of the courts will help in the speedy delivery of justice by reducing the procedural safeguards?
Not by reducing the procedural safeguards, I would say, because procedural safeguards play a very important role, but by fast-tracking those procedures. The technology has a huge potential. You know, technology can be a force multiplier. India is a country where we have such huge resource crunch compared to the population that we have, ever exploding population, and we are going to be the youngest country for the next 30, 40 years further. So this is going to be a struggle. It's not just with judicial resources. We play catch up with all resources, whether it is, you know, urban resources, water, electricity, trains, travel, everything. Similarly, judicial resources also. Now, technology has that potential to act as a tool, to become a force multiplier, where you can't add resources at the same speed that the population demands it to be. You know, we want more and more people to come to the courts of law to bring their disputes here. We can't afford people to be sorting out their disputes on the roadside. We can't afford as a nation, as a society, to be feeling happy or a sense of vindication. Isha raised the issue about women's safety, but we can't be vindicating ourselves when we see, cold-blooded murders, even of accused persons, happening in the name of, an investigation or whatever. That is not rule of law. But the point is how we amalgamate it. Because this has, litigation has been one area which has been very shy of using technology. We are very traditional in our outlook, and we feel that, you know, old world is best, and we can't be throwing out what has been a result of years and decades of the best practices, etc. But there is a lot to learn, and you will be surprised if you had the occasion. Now, two of the courts are live streaming their proceedings on YouTube. There are two high courts which have started doing it. Please watch them. There'll be a lot to learn. And you will realize that now the judges and the lawyers are both shunning from both sides, and even from clients. Today, clients are not worried that, you know, they're not insisting that we want physical hearing. They want the matters to be heard and decided. And of course, it can never replace a physical court. Let me tell you that. A physical court where you have the whole aura and the feel of the court, where, you know, you understand what is happening and the problems are not there. But there is a large number of issues that can be streamlined with the use of technology to make the processes faster, smoother, more streamlined, and in aid of justice. The actual justice will still have to be done in the traditional manner, in the time-tested manner, but the services, notices, the, you know, pleadings completion, etc. And you'll be surprised, you know, delays occasion for records to come from lower courts. If the records are all digitized, they can, you know, in a tick of a button, the records can get transferred. Otherwise, there are special messengers who are sent from court to court for bringing those records. So it's a justice delivery, rule of law preservation. They are very, very important, but very, very, Herculean tasks. It takes a lot. And I'll tell you, our registries, if you go into some of the filing sections and where records are kept, they look like the dungeons in the Harry Potter movies. They're dark, dimly lit, stuffed with files everywhere. But digitization can now be an answer to a lot more. So to aid justice, not in actual justice, but to aid justice, technology can certainly be a huge force multiplier.
And there was a lot of advice that was coming to our students throughout this webinar. But in closing, I would request you to give a condensed advice to our LLB and BLLB students who've participated as audience, and they're about to begin the legal journey at ALC. So what career advice would you like to render to them?
I think in condense, I would say, I think I've already said it all, but just to sum it up, I would say, throw yourself in, immerse yourself completely. There's no other way to do it. And if you do it anything less than that, you will not enjoy it yourself. And if you will not enjoy it, if you can't be a happy person, then how can you bring happiness or try even endeavor to bring happiness in other people's lives? You have chosen a very important path for yourself as students of law. Understand the significance of that path and really stand up to that belief. Believe in yourself, believe in the goodness of things. And try to, as activists also, try to stand with causes. We are seeing today a world where a large number of people are standing against issues. This is not good. This is not good. I'm standing in opposition of this, against this. While it is extremely important to oppose things which we perceive or believe not to be good for our family, for our nation, etc. But I would urge you to focus more on things that are positive, that are constructive, that you can stand for. So if you are, somebody who wants to give your voice, and there are enough and more things. I mean, there are, gender issues, there are disability rights, there are senior citizens' rights, there are children's issues. And if you don't like people, there's environment, there's trees, there's birds, there's animals. This space, go wherever you like. Law is something that is so enterprising and so intense that it follows life. If Elon Musk does succeed in taking us to outer space, law will have to keep pace. As more of our life has moved on virtual platforms, more of our laws are catching up. So be on a journey, be ready to be on a roller coaster. Improvise wherever you are, but enjoy. Please enjoy, because there's no other way to do it, and it won't be worth your time and effort if you don't enjoy the journey. Thank you very much.
You truly are an inspiration, and you certainly have the ability to arouse a voracious passion for law. I think this is absolutely wonderful for our students. We're indeed grateful that you accepted our invitation and could find time for us from your busy schedule. On behalf of Asian Law College, as a token of our appreciation, we'd like to present a memento to you, and it shall be reaching you very soon.
Really? Thank you very much. So nice of you. It was an absolute privilege for me, Dr. Supriya.
Thank you so much for being here, ma'am. It was wonderful for our students. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Really grateful.